I'm often invited to read from my novels in public, and if there's a question period afterwards, someone inevitably stands up to ask the following. What kind of writer do you consider yourself to be? Are you a Canadian writer or a Sri Lankan writer? It is perplexing, this matter of cultural identity, and I am tempted, like some other writers of multiple identities, to reply grumpily, I'm just a bloody writer, period. Yet this response would be disingenuous. I suppose I could answer Sri Lankan Canadian writer or Canadian Sri Lankan writer. But this also does not get to the heart of what I consider my identity to be as a writer. And we are talking about my writing identity here. For in terms of being a writer, my creativity comes not from Sri Lankan or Canadian, but precisely from the space between that marvelous open space represented by the hyphen, in which the two parts of my identity jostle and rub up against each other like tectonic plates, pushing upwards the eruption that is my work. It is from this space in between that the novels come, from a double visionness, a biculturalism. For the majority of people, dual identity is a burden forced on them by the fact that their bodies, or their skin colors to be precise, do not represent the nation state they are in, thus compelling them to constantly wear their difference on their sleeve and carry it around on their backs. In my day-to-day interaction with the world outside, I share the irritation, the burden, the occasional danger of this visible otherness. When I close the door to my study and sit at my computer, that biculturalism becomes a site of great excitement, a great marvel, the very source of my creativity. It is from this space in between, represented by the hyphen, that I have written what I consider Canadian novels set exclusively in Sri Lanka. For though the material may be Sri Lankan, the shaping of that material and the inclusion, for example, of themes of gay liberation or feminism are drawn from the life I have lived in Canada. Homosexuality is illegal in Sri Lanka, and the very real threat of physical violence and intimidation might have stopped me from exploring this theme had I lived there, being not of a particularly brave disposition. My thoughts and attitudes, indeed my craft as a writer, have been shaped by my life here in Canada. It is from the clash of these cultures which occurs in the space between lines arise. For the first 19 years of my life, questions of cultural identity never troubled me. I was born and raised in Sri Lanka, and it was clear to me who I was. That I was manifested in being a member of my immediate and extended family, to generations before us lying in the graveyard. It was manifested in my school. Various granduncles, older cousins, and even my older brother had gone there before me, and the teachers saw me in the context of this continuity, though negatively, always expressing their disappointment at my lack of sportiness compared to my forbearers. This I was embodied in the landscape, the place, names, rivers, lakes, stretches of beach, ever tied to the narrative of not just my life, but that of my parents and grandparents before me. This sense of identity remained curiously unshaken by the fact that growing up, I listened exclusively to Western pop music and read Western books. The rise of ethnic conflict between the majority Sinhalese and the minority Tamil, of whom I'm a member, because of my father, even though my mother is Sinhalese, did not shake my identity. Even the growing violence that's spilling over that violence into our lives, which will ultimately force us to leave Sri Lanka, did not disturb that sense of who I was. It was the arrival in Canada that shook it. Here, for the first time, I found myself forced, like almost all new immigrants, to ask myself those questions about who I was. What did it mean to be Sri Lankan? What aspects of my culture made me Sri Lankan? What aspects didn't? What was the essence of Sri Lankanness? The answers really furnished themselves and had actually been with me all along through my life in Sri Lanka. I had just not known it. All colonial societies in their struggle for independence and the forming of a new nation reshape and redefine their identity. This drive for cultural identity involves the establishment of a collective essential self that is shared by people with a common ancestry and common history. This essential identity seems to be unchanging and eternal. It provides a common frame of reference to a newly emerged nation. The goal of these new nations released from colonialism is to bring to light this identity that has been suppressed and distorted and disfigured by the colonial master, to express this identity through a retelling of the past. At the core of this identity lies the idea that beyond the mess and contradictions of today is a resplendent past whose existence, when it is discovered, will restore people as a culture, as a society. My problem in embracing this notion of an essential pure cultural identity was that its contradictions almost immediately bedevil me. Well, for example, did someone like me, with a Sinhalese mother and a Tamil father, belong? And what to do with that much adored grandmother of mine, with her blue eyes and white skin, who never thought of herself as anything but, well, Sri Lankan? What also to do with the pesky fact that a piece of pop music by the Bee Gees or Olivia Newton-John could take me back to my teenage years and those long tropical afternoons spent lying on my bed listening to the radio in a way that no Sri Lankan song could. In the quest for my cultural identity, I was also discovering that within Sri Lanka itself, opposition had been mounted by writers and thinkers against this notion of a pure, eternal, fixed Sri Lankan identity. Through reading these writers, I became aware that it was the very idea of a pure essential culture that had led to the rise of both Sinhala and Tamil nationalism, racism and violence. The inability of both communities to accept that they share a crossbred culture where there was more in common than different. The insistence by each that their culture was superior, the refusal by each to acknowledge that we are a little island nation to whose shores over the centuries have come the winds of other cultures that had been incorporated into what was now being hailed as a pure culture in Sri Lanka. I could not ignore that it was this very notion of purity that ultimately brought such violence to my family and forced us out of Sri Lanka. On a personal level, I was also beginning to come to terms with being gay, beginning to live out another very important part of my identity. It was very clear to me that the pure sense of being Sri Lankan was based on rigid heterosexual and gender roles. Where did someone like me belong then? By being gay, was I no longer Sri Lankan? And if that was not the case, what did it mean to be both Sri Lankan and gay? How to live out this combination of identities? Some of the answers to these questions came through my understanding of the concept of diaspora. The word diaspora, a term unfamiliar to many who are diasporic themselves, comes from Greek and implies a scattering of seed. Immigrant is often used to identify diasporic groups, and indeed the writers coming from these groups. The problem with this term is that the emphasis is on the act of arrival in a new land. It conveys a sense that someone is a perpetual newcomer, a perpetual outsider. The term immigrant does not leave much room for the process of becoming and changing and the dynamic cultural mixing that diaspora suggests. Diaspora also allows for the encompassing a wider range of people and experiences. On the one hand, the idea of diaspora acknowledges that the history and culture from which we have come is not an illusion. Histories are real. They have produced concrete and symbolic results. And the past still informs who we are. And the truth is that the discovery of hidden histories has played a very important function in many social movements of our time, feminist, gay, anti-colonial, anti-racist. As such, it should not be dismissed outright. A collective identity can be very effective as a tool of resistance and empowerment and freedom. On the other hand, the idea of diaspora acknowledges the act, the trauma of migration, and the fact that one cannot but be transformed in a new land. the emphasis must shift to a sense of cultural identity that is eclectic and diverse. A sense of cultural identity that is transforming itself, making itself new over and over again. A continuous work in progress. This sense of cultural identity, while taking into account that a group or a culture might have many important points of similarity, also acknowledges that there are many points of difference between its people, and that these differences, such as sexuality and gender and class, also define who we are. This sense of cultural identity stresses not just who one was in the past, but who one might be in the process of becoming. Just going to read briefly from Halima. Now, into this world comes a cousin from abroad, whom the other cousins promptly nickname her Fatness. And her Fatness, because she's the new kid, has to play the most boring role in Bride Bride, the role that nobody else wants to play, which is, of course, the groom. Now, her Fatness is not pleased with the situation, and I'm going to read to you the part where the bride and groom finally clash. When lunch is over, my grandparents retire to their room for a nap. The other adults settle in the drawing room to read the newspaper or doze off in the huge armchairs. We, the bride-to-be and the bridesmaids, retire to the servants' room for the long-awaited ritual of dressing the bride. We were soon disturbed, however, by the sound of booming laughter. At first we ignored it, but when it persisted, getting louder and more drawn out, my sister Sunali went to the door and looked out. Her slight cast brought us all out onto the porch. There the groom strutted up and down, head thrown back, stomach stuck out. She sported a huge bristly moustache torn out of the groom, and a cigarette of rolled paper and talcum powder, which she held between her fingers and puffed on vigorously. The younger cousins, instead of getting dressed and putting the final touches to the altar, sat along the edge of the porch and watched with great amusement. "Aha, me hearties," the groom cried on seeing us. She opened her hands expansively. "Bring me my fair maiden, for I must be off to my castle before the sun settest." We looked at the groom, aghast at the change in her behavior. She sauntered towards us, then stopped in front of me, winked expansively, and with her hand under my chin, tilted my head back. "Ah," she exclaimed, a bonny lass indeed." "Stop it," I cried and slapped her hand. "The groom is not supposed to make a noise." "Why not?" her Fatness replied angrily, dropping her hearty voice and accent. "Why can't the groom make a noise?" "Because." "Because of what?" "Because the game is called Bride Bride, not Groom Groom." Her Fatness seized her moustache and flung it to the ground dramatically. "Well, I don't want to be the groom anymore. I want to be the bride." We stared at her in disbelief, amazed by her impudent challenge to my position. "You can't," I finally said. "Why not?" her Fatness demanded. "Why should you always be the bride? Why can't someone else have a chance too?" "Because," Sonali said, joining in, "because Argy's the bestest bride of all." "But he's not even a girl," her Fatness said, closing in on the lameness of Sonali's argument. "A bride is a girl, not a boy." Paraka.